I'll turn it up a bit.
While the kids head out, would you stand up and mix and say hello to somebody, tell them Jesus loves them, see how they're doing, give them a hug if they're healthy, nothing that they're going to share, but say hi to each other, come together, say hello across the aisle, will you please?
Hi, John.
How are you doing?
Good.
Good morning, folks. How are we doing, James? Can you hear me back there? Is this working?
Yeah.
Great. Good morning. It's an honor and privilege to see you this morning. Those smiling, happy faces. Not every face has been happy all week long. Has anybody had a struggle this week or a prayer request, a need? Thanks for being real. We got some more people being real. Thank you. Came across several people this week with some challenges. I got a cousin at West. His wife has cancer, and she's in her sixth round of chemo, and it's serious, and we're praying for a miracle there. Then have another cousin, all related, that came back to Toronto, went to find out some information on teeth, jaw, chest, that kind of thing, and he writes me, and he says, Mark, please pray, excuse me, choke up. He says, pray for a miracle, because it'll take a miracle. So, you can pray for them both with me, without names here. Just pray that God would do that miracle in their lives. Now, very uniquely, last night, I was over in Troy, Michigan, and worshiping at a church over there called Kensington. It's a church that keeps planting churches and keeps starting churches. They had a couple share their testimony last night, and she lost her husband very quickly to cancer. He lost his wife to cancer. Somehow through the mix of interaction over the months and years, they found each other. They formed a foundation for cancer, and they have written a book called
The Color of Rain.
The Color of Rain. Thank you. The Color of Rain. If you want to look up that book, write it down. If you know anyone who has a struggle with cancer or would like some help from a foundation or from some people who've been there and have walked the journey, and God has done a miracle in their lives. This book, The Color of Rain, this sweet lady gave me their number so I could call, and because life doesn't prepare you for this stuff, does it? I mean,
no.
There's no class at Northern or St. Clair, there's no class over at Lambda College, there's no class at any of the universities around that says, let me tell you how to prepare for one of your family members who get cancer or go through struggles and pain. This week, came across another friend, and fascinating. What happened is, this individual lost a spouse. Spouse passed away. They were gifted with an amount to live on. That amount is being depleted over the weeks and months. Son ended up in jail over something. And just crisis after crisis. Mm-hmm. And somehow, out of the blue, God gives me, you know, James, that comment you just made? God gives you a verse, just a special message. The special message was the words of God that I've seen in my lifetime that I don't practice well, that I've got to learn, that I'm passing along to this friend. And it's the words, shout unto God with a voice of what?
Praise.
Praise. Shout unto God with a voice of? Triumph. Yes. Shout unto God with a voice of
victory.
Why in the world does it say that? So, you know, I do what you do. We have YouVersion Bible Gateway, so I looked it up. And here's what it says. It says, just when you had it and then it disappears. Let me put it back in here.
That's a song by Hillsong.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Psalm 100, verse 1, shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Well, that's just for somebody else. Not for me. Somebody else needs to do the shouting. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation.
Yeah, Jesus! Woo.
Yes, we got some shouting going on. I can hear it coming. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Right, Carly?
Amen.
Raise a banner on a bare hilltop. Shout to them. Beckon to them to enter the gates. Sing for joy to God our strength. Shout aloud to the God of Jacob. Shout for joy to all the earth. You could go on and on and on and on. Have you ever tried it? You're discouraged.
Yes.
There's something going on at home. The kids are driving you crazy. And all of a sudden, mom shouts, scare the kids. That's cool. But it might even scare your spouse, might scare your mother, your father, might even scare your boss, might scare the people in the restaurant you're in, but or surprise them, or wonder, what are you shouting about? I'm shouting to the Lord because I'm trusting Him. I am putting my faith in Him.
Yeah.
I want to suggest you try that.
Right now.
Who's going to? Go ahead. Right now.
Thank you, Jesus!
I think God heard you.
Amen.
Straight from the heart. Amen,
does.
Folks.
Great, great.
I want to encourage you to try that this week. How much more and how much better that is than crawling into a cave, going into the ditch, ending up locking yourself somewhere going, I'm not going to make it. I'm just not going to make it. This is just overwhelming. I can't handle this. I can't do this. How much better for us to do what God recommends us to do, which is what?
Shout
and praise Him and give Him the glory. What a week. This week we're here to talk about judging others. We've been on a journey becoming the body of Christ at Dunamis. And you'll get a letter, and the letter starts sometime. You get a letter sometime in the near week ahead, sometime. And it starts with the little phrase, there is no place like this place, anywhere near this place, so this must be the place. Right on. And this is an incredible gift and place that God has blessed us with. Here at Dunamis, we're seeking to become the body of Christ. So last fall, we talked about spiritual gifts. For years, you've been coming hearing about the Word of God. Last fall, we said, okay, the body of Christ uses their gifts. They must use their gifts for each other. Gifts of encouragement and support and serving and helps and prayer and all kinds of things. We have got to be the body of Christ to each other, and you have a gift. You're blessed with a gift. And if you hold that gift back from me, I'm not going to grow up. So I'm going to stay an infant. I'm not going to grow up without your gift and yours and yours. I need you to bless me with your gift because I'm not going to get mature without it because I don't have it. I don't have all 30 gifts plus. I don't have them all. I need you to bless me with your wisdom, your insight, your discernment, all of the things that God has blessed you with. You have a whole lot of things I don't have. And without those things, I'll never get mature. Never. So I can sit in my private world and I can study all the verses I want. And I can go into my closet and I can just pull out the books. I can get the devotions. I can do the Greek and Hebrew. I can do whatever it is. I can listen to the podcast. I can do all of that. And I could still be immature. Because I need to open my eyes up. And there's this little thing we're going to sneak in there today. Because I sometimes judge myself. And I sometimes have others judging me. And in the judgment process, I'm getting discouraged because somebody's telling me I'm not who I should. Or I'm judging myself. And that's no good. So I need somebody to come along and tell the truth from God's word and use their gifts to help build me up and equip me because I'm heading out into that world and it's a crazy place. And I need you to get there and I need you to survive and I need you to be mature and to help me walk with God. So we need each other. I've received calls this morning. SOS calls this morning. Help. Desperate this morning from people. So there are people maybe not here this morning that need your prayer. So as you've looked around this morning and if you said good morning to people, there are some who are missing. They're missing because somebody isn't using their gifts in their life, or they feel judged or condemned. Or Satan's getting a victory because he's got a judgment over their life and doesn't want them successful and doesn't want them walking with Jesus. We need each other desperately. Then we talked about love. And we said love is patient and love is kind. So love doesn't push. Love accommodates your area of growth. Love doesn't push you and force you and manipulate you. Love is patient. Love doesn't stop with patience. Love always adds to patience kindness. Love is never patient and passive. Love always comes along and shows up with an act of kindness in the midst of the patience. So don't just be saying, I'm patient with you. No. Walk in and step into that relationship with an act of love and kindness, because love is a verb. And then it goes on to talk about all the other things we talked about that love is. And then we've been talking this year, this new year, about what it means to turn the corner of the new year. And every one of us deal with stress. And so in the last couple of weeks, we talked about what stress is and how to manage stress in our hearts and our lives, because tension's always there. Tension will never go away. Never, ever. We will never be able to live any place, anywhere in this world without stress and tension. It's impossible. And Jesus said that. He said, in this world, you're going to have what? You're going to have tribulation. You're going to have trouble. You're going to have struggles and stress and pain and suffering. And he said, but what?
But don't worry.
That's right. Don't worry, because I have overcome the world. Amen. Do you believe that?
Yes, sir.
Tell somebody beside you that, will you? Cheer them up.
Amen.
Somebody's discouraged. Let somebody behind you, in front of you, know.
You're going to overcome.
Amen. My spouse and my friend, you are going to overcome. All right. Do not let me forget to come to the end, because I'm leaving 5 minutes, because I have to read something to you from this book.
What is it called?
It's called Leaving the Light On. At the very end of this message, I have something to share with you, and it is, you better stay. So don't leave before the end, because this, I read this with my friend Lisa this week, and this is fantastic. Where do you hear this? It's build memories that will draw your kids home.
Wow. Yeah.
The bullseye of building relationships with children is that when they launch and leave, they will come back.
They long to come home.
They will. There are some kids who live in homes with parents that are so strict and so, it's all about your compliance and obedience, and that the kids leave and they can't wait to leave. Mm-hmm. And they don't want to come back. Mm-hmm. God reconciled you to himself so that you will always want to come home. He lays out a highway of forgiveness to you and me. He builds this relationship with you and me to reconcile us. We mess up. We mess up this morning. We mess up yesterday. We messed up all week. He wants us to come back home. He wants us to come back into relationship with him. He wants us to say, God, I'm sorry. I messed up. I confess. I agree. And thank you for forgiving me. Mm-hmm. So when this guy, Gary Smalley and John Trent, write this book, they say, what does it mean to build memories to draw your kids back home? What does it mean to be in a relationship with a spouse to keep that relationship close so that they're not driven away or driven out, or they don't let you drive each other away? And those things happen, and sometimes they happen in such a way that, and I've come across this week and this month, is that sometimes there's behavior, though, in a relationship, and I gotta say this, always the balance, is there's times in a relationship where there needs to be a separation from abuse, from something that is destroying your peace, destroying who you are in Christ. He didn't mean you to be in a relationship beat up and abused. and drained of every single resource you have, whatever that resource be. Now, as God keeps you strong and keeps you resilient and keeps you close to Him, God gives you the patience to manage that. Mm-hmm. But there's occasions in our life where we run out of that, or something runs out, and we have to say, time out. The police need to put you in jail because you just burned my house down. The police need to put you in jail because you just did some serious damage to one of our children, or whatever that is. I always have to say the balance. So as we love, as we pursue God, as we pursue love and patience and kindness, that is fantastic. But not when somebody slips in the category of an evil person, or a toxic, foolish person, or a sinner who is damaging your life. That's another message. We're going to come back today, so we're going to get this at the end of the message. A fantastic story here. I can't wait to share that with you because it just blessed my heart. So what does Jesus say about judging? As we walk into relationships, as we come into what we need to here at Dunamis, into small groups, and my hope and goal and dream and prayer is that every single one of you who come to this church would be in some kind of this is the big church, be in some kind of small church setting where you're loved and cared for, where you're known. Mm-hmm. Where you're not known here, make an appointment with one of us as leaders, one of the small group leaders, with myself, so that I can meet with you this week. But barring that, find yourself time to get in a small group, because God came and He formed a group of men. And how many did He choose?
12.
So be in a group of 12 or less. Jesus set the pattern. I can't do better than He does. I can't come up with a better idea than He did. He picked 12 guys. Now, in the midst of that, conflict happened. Stress happened. Difficulties happened. Arrogance happened. All kinds of weird things happened as those guys toured around the Jordan River, the Dead Sea, and all over. Bethlehem, Nazareth, all over, as they took their tour. What's that situation?
So it takes time to iron out the wrinkles.
It does. And one of the things that come up is this matter of judging. So, in Matthew chapter 7, verse 1, Jesus said this. He said, "Do not judge, or you too will be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use it, it will be measured to you." Mm-hmm. Now, there is an important time out here, because there's two types of judgment in God's Word. There's a judgment that God says don't do, and there's a judgment that says do judge. The judgment here is the judgment that says that you do not have the insight, the wisdom, the knowledge, the anything to determine if somebody's going to heaven or not. That's not your call. It's our call to live and love and tell people what Jesus did in our lives.
Lift each other up.
Lift each other up, especially in the way that how He's lifted you up. There's no better testimony than to not tell somebody what to do, but to tell what God has done in you.
Amen.
How has God saved you, redeemed you, loved you, helped you through the challenges of your day, your hard nights? So here's Jesus saying, don't judge. So when you come up to somebody, it's not for you to determine whether or not that person's going to heaven or not. Now, there's a judgment over here that is Genesis to Revelation, especially Matthew to Revelation style, that Jesus says that you can analyze. You can use your analytical understanding to determine whether or not a child is going to burn themselves on a stove, in the same way you can determine whether or not a person, in terms of their behavior, is going to damage their marriage or hurting their relationship with their kids, or going to get fired at work. And so you have the opportunity to say, hey, brother, that's not a good idea to do what you're doing. I want to encourage you and lift you up. So there's a judgment there that's healthy and balanced and encouraged in the one another's all the way through the New Testament and some of the Old. So I just wanted to make the distinction carefully. And as you study, you'll determine when is judging not good and when is judging appropriate. So you judge others when, and we're going to start here, when you're more upset at someone else's sin than you are at your own. Isn't it something? It's so easy to find fault with others. And it's like, no faults here. Everything's good here. Pretty perfect here. But it isn't. How do we get that way? We get that way because we're not living in James. James chapter 5:16. We get that way because we're not living with James. Thank you, James. Because we're not, James 5:16 says, confess your faults to one another. In order to confess your faults to one another, it sort of precludes that while I'm confessing my faults to God, my own. It's like, did you have a time this morning before you came to church or before you worshiped? Carly, fantastic worship time, thank you. Before we worshiped here this morning, did you say, God, I'm here to clean up? I just want to clean up. You know, we washed our faces, we had a shower, you know, all those other things went out. Tomorrow's our garbage day, it's already out of the street. Did you have that cleanup time today or yesterday, sometime? Because then it says, okay, after you've done that, then you come in with brothers and sisters and you say, hey, look, I'm struggling. I just want you to know I'm struggling. I got messages this morning, somebody was struggling, but in a different way, right? But are you honest enough about your struggles and honest to share with others that you're human? God wants us to live in that atmosphere. Then when we come to this, it's not so hard. Because in Matthew 7, a few verses after the one we just read, he says Matthew 7:3. And this is amazing. What a great verse.
Love it.
Why do you look at the what?
Speck.
Give me, use your finger and pick a speck. Okay? All right? Now, get your arm around the plank. Will you give me the picture of a plank, please? Yes. Okay, we got some planks back there. That's great planks. Okay, so why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay little attention or no attention to the plank in your own eye?
Amen.
How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there's a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the plank out of your own eye, then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. There's a guy, have any of you ever heard of a man named Dietrich Bonhoeffer?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, some of you have read some of his, he's a wise gentleman, author. He said that one of the first signs of Christian maturity is a frustration with the hypocrisy in the church and a desire to separate from it. Is that people go, well, there's just a bunch of hypocrites in the church. Well, they are at the grocery store too, but I still go to the grocery store. They are at the Canadian Tire, but there I still go there. They are at the, you know, I mean, they're everywhere. They might even find one in Tim's or Starbucks or somewhere. And I still get my coffee and tea there. It's like people go, well, there's imperfect people in the church. Well, forget them. Well, I am too. So you better get out of here because I'm imperfect and I need Jesus. And I need your love and I need your encouragement and I need your prayer to be who Jesus wants me to be. I'm telling you that straight out. And so this is why Jesus, at the front end with his disciples, has this privilege of saying, hey guys, we just did this Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are you who are peacemakers, and so on. And only two chapters later, he's saying this. He's saying, guys, I feel the judgment coming on here. And you guys, Matthew, you think you're pretty cool. You know, and James, you think you're pretty hot stuff. And Peter, you're walking on water. Yeah, yeah. You know, but... and on they went, these disciples, as they walked with Jesus, and they started judging each other. And so Jesus goes, hey, time out, guys. Can't let this happen. Mm-hmm. And here's what happens when we get into small groups. And as we become a family, our imperfections come out. Mm-hmm. We may end up in each other's homes. We may end up at a restaurant with each other and watch how somebody treats the waiter or waitress. Mm-hmm. We may be in a shop, whether that be in an automobile shop or somewhere, and we see how somebody treats each other, and we go, ooh, you know, and then the judging starts, and then the conversation starts, and it's like Jesus goes, hey, remember who you are, and remember how much I loved you, and remember where you came from, and so let's keep that in mind and not do this judging thing. Well, the next sign of growth in our life is not just recognizing that there's hypocrisy, yes, all around. It's in us, and we manage it. So we may, if any time you get ready to confront others, and I've got a small group that actually picked the subject of criticism in the last week, and it happened to be the person who struggles with criticism says, help. So I said, well, take the study. And so this guy took the study, and he's studying criticism. What we can do with criticism is this, is we can try to come up with techniques of changing our words. Jesus says when it comes to criticism, change your heart. When you change your heart, your words will change. When you realize how much Jesus loves you and there's heart change in you, the words will come. Because he says what comes out of a man's mouth comes from his what?
Heart.
Comes straight from his heart. So God wants to do a heart change in me and in you this morning. Let him right now. Start that right this minute. And just say, God, change my heart. I'm struggling. I'm struggling with all kinds of things in terms of this judgment. So free me. Okay.
Amen.
Number two here is you refuse to forgive. If you're judging others, you refuse to forgive. Has anybody ever struggled to forgive anybody? That's basically about all of us. Matthew 6:15 says, but if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive you. Interesting. Tucked in between, Jesus sitting with his disciples, very first shot at it, on the field, where he says, blessed are you, and he gives them this tour of how to behave and how to talk and how to live. And then Matthew 7, where it talks about judging, he comes back here and says, hey guys, disciples, Peter, James, John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, but if you do not forgive others their sins, guys, my Father won't forgive you. That's pretty powerful. Is that wishy-washy?
Nope.
Is there any way around that?
Nope.
Well, how about exceptions?
Nope.
There just aren't any.
It's not even open to a different interpretation.
It isn't. There is no room and wiggle room to come up with another idea. Thanks, Bill. Okay, Luke 6:37. Do not judge, and you will not be judged.
Amen.
Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. You want a highway paved to your heart of forgiveness? It's when you forgive others.
Yep.
Now, again, I caution you, where's the balance? What about the fact that somebody keeps hurting me, cheating on me, lying to me, stealing from me, you know, doing all kinds of horrible things? What happens then? You keep forgiving. But, caution, do you trust? You loan somebody your credit card or your car or whatever it is. They smashed the car. They blew out the credit card. They maxed it out to 20 grand, 50 grand, whatever it was. Do you give it back to them? You pay it out, give it back. What do you do? No.
Wisdom says no.
Wisdom, thank you. The person with the gift of wisdom comes along with that person who's seeking to forgive and be in relationship and say, I totally forgive you, but there's a pathway back to me trusting you.
Mm-hmm. Trust is earned, grace is given.
Amen. Say that louder.
Trust is earned, grace is given.
Thanks, Kurt. You must have experienced this at some point in your life. Right on. So see Kurt for those stories. Okay. It's to refuse to forgive someone is to be almost entirely ignorant of the enormity of God forgiving you. Do you remember the beautiful story that he gives where he says to that woman, the Pharisees were criticizing him, Jesus his feet are being washed by the woman who had a reputation. And Jesus goes, he who has been forgiven much loves much. But he who has been forgiven little loves little. Wow. Do you want to be a person with a whole lot of love? You're a person that realizes you've been forgiven a whole lot.
Mm-hmm.
Something we need to teach our kids. Something we need to demonstrate in our relationships with our family and friends. That we just out loud say, man, thank you for forgiving me. In front of our kids. You know, mom, dad, boyfriend, girlfriend, friends, thank you for forgiving me, that they would hear that. And then you would say, well, it was a place, and all the conflict happened somewhere in some other moon, some other planet. Kids need to, they don't need to see parents in this knockdown dragout, but they do need to see you and watch you work through conflict.
Mm-hmm.
How in the world are they going to know if they don't see you resolving conflict?
Exactly.
With anybody. And if you're not in a relationship with somebody, then don't go out and create conflict. I'm not saying that. But don't go out and make something happen just so you can have a story. There's plenty of it around. So anyway, God will bless you as you seek to honor him and forgive. So judging means a person is refusing to forgive. And forgiving means to release the person from the debt. It's like, you owe me, right? When somebody does damage to you, you go, you owe me. There's a process given in Matthew 18, and today isn't about this. It's a whole separate package. But in that process, Jesus gives a 1-2-3 process. If your brother, sister, friend, kid, anybody offends you, go and show them. Lay it out, their fault. Now, this isn't about checking off the thing. This is about doing everything you can in the entire world to resolve that one issue. It's doing, because what does God care about? God cares about bringing people back into restoration, in relationship. Some people discipline for obedience. That matters to God. But God disciplines for a relationship, because he loves you and he wants to be in relationship with you and me. So parents, if you've been disciplining for obedience just to get compliance and get them to do what you want them to do, and then you get it and you're like, yeah, yeah, got it. And then they walk off and the kid just walks away from you. Child doesn't come back into your arms and hug you then. But if you discipline for a relationship, that child comes back and sits in your lap and says, thanks for your love, mom, dad, friend. That's the purpose of Matthew 18 when he says, go and show them his fault. If they listen, you won. Your brother won. There's a heart-to-heart unity. Then it says, if he doesn't listen to you, then find somebody else great, loving, kind. Don't find somebody else who's going to go, yeah, I agree with you, they're a jerk. That's not Matthew's point. It's find somebody wonderful who's in the nurturing situation who says, I found somebody who will help our marriage. I found somebody who will help our relationship. And honey, or so-and-so, or friend, or child, here they are. And we're going to help you with this issue, with this problem. And then if they go, okay, didn't work in number one, didn't work in number two, then we're going to take the church. So find somebody in the church who has struggled with this, who has had trouble with this, and they come into the relationship. Why? To confront them and say, got you. You know? No, you walk into the situation and bring that person who has been in your shoes, been in those shoes, and you bring that person to help resolve that issue. Why? Mm-hmm. Because I want you in relationship with God. Mm-hmm. And because I'm out of relationship with you and this is not good.
That's right.
If churches would follow God's pattern, wow. If families would follow God's pattern, wow. Okay, so number three. You judge a person when you cut off, when you're upset at someone else's sin more than you are at your own, you refuse to forgive, and you cut off anyone who disagrees with you. Oh, man. Anybody do social media? Has anybody ever cut off somebody in social media, like, zing, block,
nope.
You know, defriend or whatever you call that thing, you know, off Twitter or off Snapchat or, you know, Facebook or Instagram or, you know, or just life. It's like at Christmas time and birthdays and New Year's and all this stuff, I'm coming across people who family members don't talk to each other because somebody cut somebody off because they disagreed. It's like, I don't like the way you said this, or I don't like the way you eat that or do that, or, you know, on and on it goes. That's the essence of judging, is when you disagree so strongly with someone over something like faith or morality or politics, and because you can't agree, you cut them off.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we say that to Satan, folks. Depart from me.
Mm-hmm.
That's cool. That's okay. You're supposed to do that. Jesus said, depart from me, Satan. Mm-hmm. Jesus has already locked him up. His future is certain. It's a done deal for eternity. But hear me kindly on this. You have to love the person more than you love your particular stance on an issue or opinion.
That's right.
That doesn't mean, though, that you compromise your position. I'll go to something super sensitive that I would prefer you cut off the video on this one, but you don't have to. We're talking about homosexuality, the gay movement. Mm-hmm. I have family members who are gay. I know what God says, so I don't compromise my position, but I don't cut them out of my life either. Because somebody differs and lives a different lifestyle than I live, Jesus loves them. You remember our friend Jim, who we had here a couple months ago? Find the dunamis date and listen to his story about he, for most of his life, was in a homosexual relationship. And God led him through Jesus Christ into a relationship back to Christ. And he talks about that whole story. And now every day of his life, he's out there. We need to pray for him. He's out there sharing his story and seeking to reach people who are in that community, the gay community, LGBT community, wherever they are, or family members that have someone heading that direction or in that place. Mm-hmm. And so you don't compromise your position, but you love the person and you don't cut them out of your life. You continue to share Jesus and love them where they're at. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I didn't want to get complicated. I didn't want to go off into that. We could talk more about that personally, privately, and in a setting where it might help you if you need more. Okay? Mm-hmm. But Jesus offered his hand of friendship to everybody. Jew and who?
Gentile.
And he said, I came, I didn't come for the cleaned up people, I came for sinners. And he hung around and spent time and sought to win people to Jesus. I love the way Jesus did life. Remember, he did it with his core guys. And with his core guys, his team, not alone, with his team, he went and met people's needs. Because even Jesus, somehow, who is God, said, I need 12 guys. Jesus wasn't so cocky that he goes, it's me and the Father. I don't need any of you. We can handle this. Jesus didn't want to handle anything, including picking up loaves and fishes. He wanted help. So he enlisted people to help him. How many people are you enlisting to help you live life right now, this week? How many friends? How many gifts? How many people are you humbling yourself saying, like Jesus, I want people in my life?
Yeah.
Folks, we got to get to this story. We got to finish up. Sorry, I got to move along.
All right.
Next one, you gossip, okay? Now, you judge others when you gossip. We got to eliminate that. Gossip, there's two things, gossip and slander. Gossip means I talk about you or you talk about me behind my back. Now, you may be telling something true. It may be true. Did I use deodorant? It's true. Did I need it? It's true. But tell me to my face, Bill. I mean, you know? Anyway, I'm kidding. So, if you've got something to say, say it. And tell somebody to their face and not behind their back. God says a lot of things about gossip. Proverbs 26:22. He says, the words of a gossip are like choice morsels. They go down into the innermost parts. Have you ever been hurt by gossip? Yeah. And then there's slander. Slander is taking something that is not true and spinning it as though it is true to hurt and damage and just get vindictively back in a bitter, resentful way at someone. Here's what 2 Corinthians 12:20 says, for I'm afraid when I come, I may not find you as I want you to be, and you may not find me as you want me to be. I fear that there may be, and as part of the package, catch the package here. Gossip is in this package. Mm-hmm. Discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, slander, and what?
Gossip.
Arrogance and disorder. It's a package. Oftentimes it comes in our hearts and lives as a package. It doesn't belong to Jesus' followers.
No.
What belongs to Jesus' followers is, hey, I want to tell you about so-and-so. What can we do to help them and pray for them? Let's go. Will you go with me? Will you help me win them? Will you help me help them through that addiction, that struggle, that affair, that divorce, that whatever? Excuse me. What makes gossip so dangerous is that you judge someone without giving them a chance to change. Mm-hmm. God wants to change us, to make us like Jesus. Gossiping cuts off that opportunity. Stop it. Go to them and say, you want to do this? You want to see this change in your life, this relationship with your son or daughter, husband, wife, friend, boss, anybody? Let me help you. I'm going to do everything I can to pray for you. No gossip. Let's shoot straight and away we go. And don't go, oh, I've got a prayer request. You know, so-and-so is such a jerk. You know, we just got to pray for them because they're such an idiot. No. And don't go, bless their, don't do the southern thing, oh, bless their heart for being such an idiot. You know, such a fool. No. None of that. That's still gossip, and that's still wrong, and that's still not something that Jesus calls us to do, because it's in a package that is opposed to what Jesus calls us to do as believers. Let's work on this carefully. Number five, you refuse to receive feedback. I love accountability, and I love feedback. So if you want to give me feedback about today, about anything, I welcome it. Because why? Because I want to be a better person. I want to be a better pastor. I want to be a better friend. Give me feedback. Tell me how to do that. I'm open. I hope you are too. I hope you're not. I hope you don't put your hand up in front of somebody's face and block them and say, I'm not interested in anything you have to say. 1 Thessalonians says this, we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive. That means that people got to get involved in this feedback process. If you're going to be warned, you need to accept the warning. Warn those who are idle and disruptive. People get idle. People get disruptive. Encourage the disheartened. Help the weak. Be patient. With who?
Everyone.
Everyone. There needs to be feedback with everyone. Why do people hate criticism? Is it that we can't admit our own faults? Why is it that we're so opposed to somebody saying, hey, I wish you would change this in your life? Why are we not rushing into relationships with others to say, hey, can you tell me? What do you want me to change? What can I do to be a better friend? Couples, I got a gigantic free tip for you. You need to have complain, moan, moments built into your relationship where every week you say, is there anything you have to share with me? Build it in. Yes, you have praise moments, and the praise moments need to be 10 for the one. 10 praises for one criticism, if you offer the criticism. But the moment where you step forward so that you cannot find out in 5 years from now or 20 years from now that this person is gone because whatever. So you find out either every day or every week, what is it that I'm doing that isn't good? What is it I'm doing that drives you nuts? I have these idiosyncrasies. I know I do. And I'll do my best to change, but what is it that I can do? So the moments in a relationship where you ask, where you find out, where you encourage the person to speak. When you understand the gospel of Jesus Christ, that every day we're changing, you understand that it's okay to change. It's okay to get input. It's okay to get feedback. So much more to say. We've got to move on. Two final ones. You refuse to exhort or admonish someone who's failing. And fantastic verses here. Hebrews 3:13. Encourage one another. How often? What's it say?
Every day.
Every day. As long as it is called today. So that none of you may be what?
Hardened.
If you don't encourage, people get hard. If you don't exhort, people get hard. If you're not open to confession, you get a hard heart. And a hard heart ends up with a broken relationship. A hard heart ends up in catastrophes of relationship. Colossians 3:16 says, oh man, Let the message of Jesus Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms and hymns and spiritual songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. Wow. Just take that one today. Run with that one. Whew. Admonishing is good. Hey, honey, can I admonish you? Nope. This is not it. Sundays, day off admonishing. Nope, don't want it. Hey, brother, can I admonish you? No. God goes, but he says, do it with wisdom. It'd be great to add music. Give us some admonishing music. Hey, sister. But this is what God says. This is the context of this flow and kindness and encouragement. It's not this grating, just friction, just like, I can't stand, you know. That's not admonishment. So, when we refuse to encourage somebody, does that mean that you don't want the best for them? When you refuse to admonish somebody, does that mean you don't want to help them become a better Christian? You don't want to help them become more like Christ? Oh, I don't want to say anything. Oh, no, I'm not saying anything. No. God says, do it. Exhort and admonish. Why? Because you care enough that somebody takes a step towards Jesus. Don't leave them uncomfortable. Best deal here is ask permission. And they give you permission, share your heart. Final one, don't write somebody off as hopeless. When we judge people, we're like, there's no hope. Boy, I got that a couple times this week. It was really sad. Is that I want no relationship with these people. I'm done. I am absolutely done. I'm 100% done. Wow. Romans 5:1. Here's this incredible passage. Therefore, since we, you, me, have been justified through faith in Jesus Christ, we have what?
Peace
with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we glory in our sufferings because we know that suffering, and catch this, we're heading to hope. Because suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance produces character. And character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. And that person who realizes that goes to Corinthians, and in the midst of being in the body of Christ, in the midst of sharing their gifts, they come to the end of Corinthians and they say, love never fails because love hopes. Say that with me. Love hopes what?
All things.
Because love never gives up. So the person who judges gives up. The person who doesn't judge doesn't give up. So much more to share, but I promise this story. Catch this story, folks. This is absolutely fantastic story. So, get comfortable. Lean back. You know, put your feet up on the chair in front of you. Here's story time. Ready? And this is shared, not me, this is shared by these authors, Gary and John. I don't know which one wrote this, but this is great. By now, he's saying at the end of this book here, all of this, okay, and coming to these last few pages of the book, this is where he says we come from. By now you've received enough instruction on increasing family closeness to design a 1,000-watt home. You've seen how to add brilliance by using affirming words, by clarifying and valuing your differences, and sparkle by ridding your home of anger. You've seen how to bring the wiring of your home up to code by resolving conflict, and discover how honor can illuminate your best efforts like a searchlight. Just takes a book. I asked somebody this week, and I pause. I asked somebody this week, in the last 10 years, have you purchased a book a year for the sake of your marriage? And this man, this husband, said no. I said, will you? Will you do that this year? $20. $20. Get one. Anyway, this is worth it. This last page is worth the whole thing. But before you put the book down and want to leave, we want to leave you with a few thoughts to help you get extra life out of the love you show others. And to do that, let's take a look at one shining example on the pages of God's Word. Here it is. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. He led them to a high mountain by themselves, and there he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as the light. While he was still speaking, a cloud enveloped them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, whom I love and whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." That's found in Matthew 17, 1 to 3 and verse 5. Jesus was standing on a lonely mountain with a few of his closest friends when this transfiguration took place. But to help us understand how great a source of light and hope and inspiration it was for his disciples, let's look at this scene in modern terms. Imagine a very mediocre college football team facing the unhappy prospect of playing an unbeaten national champion on the champion's home turf. A thunderous roar greets the favored team as they enter the stadium. As the fearful visitors emerge from the tunnel and take the field, they see why their opponents are 4 touchdown favorites. The champs are big, they're strong, they're fast, they're swaggering in their confidence. The underdogs would give anything to win, but how intimidated they feel by the awesome team they face. You feel like that? Then imagine a transfiguration. Imagine. As the outmanned visitors take the field, they suddenly, the whole team, sees this vision before them. A vision more real than anything any one of them have ever seen in their lifetime before. They see themselves sweat-streaked and dirty and bruised and bandaged, but wildly cheering. In the vision, they're all looking at the scoreboard, and in the vision, this is how the scoreboard reads. Time, completely out, 0-0-0. Quarter, fourth. Visitors, 14. National champs, 13. Get the picture? As quickly as they see the vision, it disappears. But while everything in the stadium still looks the same, they're different inside. Imagine the encouragement and wild elation seeing the end of the game would give them as they kicked off. What energy and confidence they would each take into every quarter of the play. They'd happily take the hits, the gang tackles, the bone-jarring collisions, knowing that their efforts and sacrifice and pain would not be in vain. They were going to go home champions. They saw a picture of what could be and what would be and what is going to be. That's exactly what the disciples saw when they stood with their Lord Jesus on that desolate mountain. All their effort, all their sacrifice, all their trials would endure and would not be hollow. Why? Because they'd seen the light at the end of the tunnel. At the end of the long dark passage, they caught a glimpse of how the game would end. In what? In victory, in glory, forever. Those disciples got to stand in the brightest of all lights for a few moments, a light radiating from the glorified face of Jesus Christ. And it changed their lives forever. And as we reflect on this story, here's a final challenge, and I got to end there because our time's up. And we'll share that with you. I can take a picture. There's more to the story, but I hope you get the point. Jesus knows your end, and it's glorious. It's victorious. Amen. He's already won.
Amen.
What are you struggling for?
Right?
What are you not looking at the end of the vision for? Heaven is there for you in every single way. Let's stand together and praise God for that. Heavenly Father, we as a group of people here at Dunamis, we are not going to be judging. We are not going to be judging anybody's salvation. We're going to be going out winning people to Jesus and showing them the vision that Jesus gave his disciples. One of Jesus loving and forgiving and encouraging and supporting us all the way to eternity. God, we need each other. Father, is in this room here, there's somebody, there's someone. There's a dad or mom. There's a friend. There's a son or daughter. There's somebody in this room that needs support and encouragement and love. They do not need a nasty word, a piece of gossip. They need your love and encouragement and kindness. They need patience. They need somebody to come alongside this week, this day, and do lunch, have coffee, be invited to a home, God, may they step out and say, I need help. May others say, how can I help? Help us to be that place in our homes and lives. May this be a church where people get into circles of small groups and glorify you and encourage one another with this vision. God, there's others who aren't here at all who need a phone call and a follow-up and some prayer and encouragement in their lives because they're so discouraged by something that's happening or happened. And so, God, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for this place this morning. Thank you for those who looked after the children. God, help us to thank them and appreciate them and add to their number week after week. Thank you for those who have given and loved. And, God, we look forward to doing life together this week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Say hello. We'll see you next week and sometime during the week.